inspection, search, seizure, arrest, recovery, provisional attachment, and these are important terms as on date. Lot of news in the market for the search and seizure, arrest provision. Today we are going to deliberate what are the provision existing under GST law for the search and seizure or arrest provision, recovery provision, provisional attachment provision. Whether these provisions are properly implemented, as taxpayer always look for ease of business. So we will discuss at length, and we got a learned speaker also. They are going to deliberate the topic with a constitutional validity, whether these provisions are constitutionally valid, or it can be debated at length when it is properly used and when it is not properly used. In my theme presentation, my objective would be to ignite your mind, to penetrate your mind of all the participants attendees today, so that you get prepared for the topic which we are going to deliberate today at length with a number of judgment, citation, practical example. In my theme presentation, I'm going to touch base six important parameter of today's webinar as a theme presentation. If I look at the provision first, inspection, search, and seizure. Inspection provision are being given under Section 67. And Section 67 says that any proper officer, not below the rank of Joint Commissioner. So this power is given to a senior government official, not below the rank of Joint Commissioner. He may authorize other officer as well, but for that authorization, there has to be form GST INS 01. Having reason to believe, that is how the provision is being worded, having reason to believe. And what is this reason to believe? All of you will agree with me, this term is so subjective. What is reason to believe in the mind of tax officer, who is a proper officer? To my mind, reason to believe should be supported and substantiated by solid background of the case. It should not be apprehension. Just you are having apprehension that someone is evading the taxes. Apprehension is not reason to believe. There has to be due diligence, proper checking and verification before initiating any inspection, search, and seizure provision. So reason to believe, I was just seeing some of the judgment and the judgment, the subtle legal jurisprudence, and you will find divergent judgment also, only on term reason to believe. In my humble submission, this term which is being provided to give wider power in the hands of proper officer should not be used as a mechanical provision in ordinary course of business. It should be used only in exceptional circumstances, duly backed by due diligence, proper checking and verification. Then only such activity like inspection, search and seizure should be initiated. But the wording of this provision is like that, having reason to believe that any taxpayer, it's suppressing. Suppressing means he's hiding the information. And why he will hide the information? Quite obvious, for the evasion of taxation, no doubt. So he just suppressing, therefore specific situation is being created under Section 67, subsection 1 of CGST Act. First is supply of goods or services. So if a taxpayer engage and suppressing supply of goods or services, then inspection can be initiated. So the question, important question, would be coming to your mind: what is the meaning of separation of supply of goods or services? I can take an example of sanitizer. Sanitizer is being disputed whether chargeable at the rate of 12% or 18%, right? Recently, circular got issued and it is being stated it is 18% taxable. So there was interpretation whether sanitizer is a medicament chargeable to 12% or 18%. So my only submission to all of you would be: separation of supply of goods or services, as I understand, if there is taxable value 100 rupees and I'm showing as 80 rupees, that is called separation of supply of goods or services. But anything which is going on interpretation pertaining to HSN or SSC code, classification or rate, and because of that, it cannot be alleged there is separation for supply of goods or services. I'm just giving food for thought. Second situation, stocking goods. So you're stocking, taxpayers stocking goods with an intention. No proper accounting and records kept, evasion of taxation. And third situation is given that taxpayer is availing and claiming ITC, excess claiming of ITC. So two things as an example. There can be number of transaction can be discussed from department perspective. Department may dispute that taxpayer availing credit as per books of accounts and which is not matching with GSTR 2A or 2B. So department may say you are claiming excess credit because it is not coming in 2A or 2B. Let me clarify to you. These are the term excess claiming ITC. We have to really understand. Like I gave the example, 2A, 2B, for availing credit in GSTR 3B, is there any relevance? Important one. To my mind, there is no relevance as per the GST law as on date. I can substantiate also. For an example, you can say that I'm a supplier and you all are recipient. If I'm supplying goods or services to you, if I have wrongly furnished the GST number of some other party, it will not come in your 2A or 2B. But you're entitled, you can avail credit because you're satisfying four conditions under section 16, subsection 2, credit is available. Or maybe I'm capturing B2B supply as a B2C supply, which I could not amend because time limit got expired. Third situation, let's say I'm supplying from Delhi to Maharashtra, interstate IGST leviable, but furnished as an intrastate, C plus S, may not be coming in your 2A or 2B. Or a transaction which I have not furnished in GSTR 1 but paid the taxes by GSTR 3B, even though not coming in 2A or 2B, but credit is available. So can it be termed as an excess claim of ITC? And I can also give you one important provision. As per Clause 100, Finance Bill 2021, there's a fifth condition under Section 16, Subsection 2 going to be inserted. And this subclause AA is very important, which is talking about if recipient and buyer is availing credit on the basis of invoice and debit note raised by the supplier, then such supplier must furnish such invoice and debit note in a GSTR 1. So as it would be coming and auto-populated in 2A, 2B of the recipient. And it must be communicated by supplier to the recipient. And this is prospective clause yet to be notified. So this 2A or 2B, which is existing as on date, it is only by way of rule. There is no backing of the provision. This backing of the provision now subclause AA yet to be notified. So I do not find the relevance of 2A or 2B for availing credit. Can it be said that I have excess claim of ITC, my books of accounts satisfying 4 condition under section 16, subsection 2, can it be stated that I have excess claim? To my mind, no. It may be disputed by department that recipient and buyer has availed credit, but his supplier, even after collecting the tax, has not deposited. Can you deny and penalize recipient and buyer who has bona fide paid the amount to the supplier? Supplier defaulted. Can you say that this credit is not available to the recipient? To my mind, and I can say, period prior to GSTR 2A, you cannot allege and penalize the recipient, because this recipient and buyer was not knowing even, because GSTR 2A came sometime in the beginning of 2019, which was supposed to come from July 17. So none, neither recipient nor the tax department was knowing the supplier even after collecting, not paying the taxes. So period prior to GSTR 2A, recipient can defend his case. But I'm saying, can it be termed as excess claiming of ITC? I'm just giving food for thought example. And last condition, and which you will surprise to note, these are the part of the provision. If there is any contravention of the provision of the act or rules made there under, so it is wide power given in the hands of officer to go for inspection, even if there is any contravention of the provision of the act. Such wide power given, and in the name of wide power, we are finding these inspections are becoming regular, a new norm of normal business, which should not be the case. Inspection, search and seizure should be invoked only when you have solid background. Department must be knowing that there is evasion of tax going on, and they have data and background material for substantiation. Lot of judgment in favor of a taxpayer. Without having reason to believe, you cannot go for inspection, search and seizure. For search and seizure, there are two conditions. There are goods liable for the confiscation. There has to be goods liable for the confiscation. And second, any document, books or things are being secreted at any place, subject to, with an intention to evade taxes. This need to be proved. Then only search and seizure is viable, and that too with the authority of law, like INS 02 for the search, proper form which we must check. And whenever seizure is being done, properly seized. And if order of provision is being given, then INS 03. So these are the compliances. But I'm telling you, these are the parameter. First point. Second point, summon. Before initiating anything, department is being given power, and any proper officer, and who is proper officer under GST law is being defined under section 2, subsection 91 of CGST Act. Any commissioner or any other officer authorized by him for undertaking the function under the GST Act, such proper officer can issue a summon. And the summon can be issued to any person, the word used, any person, to enforce attendance of a person or production of document, books or things. Now, my humble submission, when these summons are being issued for the production of document, books and things, we are into GST regime where we are filing online return. All the information is available with the department. And whenever we get summoned, we normally find they are asking for the GST return. They are asking copies of relevant invoices. Yes, invoices to certain extent acceptable that they can demand. But such summon should be issued only when they are having proper reason in their mind that they require enforcement, attendance of any person, and to invite any person to be present before them. I have seen the summon is being issued higher up in the authority. They start with the director, CEO, CFO. Why it is being required? You can ask the tax manager to come before you, give the statement and produce the books, document things, whatever you want for your inspection, search and seizure. But the only thing why it is being asked at first go to invite director of finance, CEO, CFO, to my mind, these are excessively used and excessively delegated power. Now, for summon, it is being stated, and whatever, you know, proceedings is being done before the proper official, it is called judicial proceedings. Under section, Indian Penal Code of 193 and 228, judicial proceedings. And such powers are being given like a civil court under Code of Civil Procedure 1908. One precaution you must take, that there is compulsorily mentioning of DIN number, document identification number, and it is coming from CGST department, from CGST perspective. Two circulars are being issued, circular number 122 and 128. 128 got issued on 23rd December 2019, and it is being stated that all communication which is being sent by CGST officer must have DIN number. Otherwise, that communication, either through an email or a letter or a summon or any so-called notice, should be held as a ultra vires void, null and void. So you must ensure whenever you are getting any documentation, any notice, any email from the CGST department, kindly check whether there is DIN number or not. But we are into one nation, one tax. It is only from CGST perspective. But what about SGST department? When they are issuing some notices, they are sending some kind of summon, is there any mention of DIN number? So state has not issued such kind of compulsorily quoting of DIN number. Kerala has taken the initiative, but it is supposed to be by all the state, so that we can say it is one nation, one tax. It cannot vary that the central is having some provision and states are having different provision. But that is how the summon which we are referring to. Coming to the third pointer for today's webinar, arrest provision. And you would be knowing and having a lot of news that arrests are now becoming new normal. Whereas arrest is supposed to be rarest of rare in exceptional circumstances. If you go to section 69, where power to arrest lies with the commissioner, and commissioner can authorize his officer as well. And how it is being worded? Commissioner is having reason to believe. Again, the one tagline, reason to believe, and which I'm saying reason to believe should not be used in normal sense. You must have information, and that information must be 100% correct. You have some background material, due diligence. It should not be mechanical, ordinary, normal. So whenever you are arresting a person, make sure things are properly checked. And second thing which can be debated, whether arrest can be made without issuance of show cause notice, without passing of assessment order. It can be debated at length, but I'm just giving food for thought. And what is being stated in section 69, if any person, whoever has committed or causes to commit and retaining the benefit, the four offenses, specified offenses under section 132 subsection 1 are liable for the arrest provision. And what are those four offenses? And these offenses are, first, supply of goods or services without issuance of invoice, which is called cash sale. You're suppressing. Second, issuance of invoice without supply of goods or services, and which is the case of fake invoice. Only invoice is being issued, but no supply of goods or services. And third, buyer and recipient is taking credit on such invoices, which is wrong availment and utilizing the credit. And last, GST collected but not deposited, fails to pay beyond a period of 3 months from the due date of payment of taxes. So four offenses. So if there is any tax evasion, ITC wrongly availed or utilized, or erroneous refund, an amount is exceeding 5 crore, tax amount exceeding 5 crore or more, then this is called non-bailable offense, and it is liable for the imprisonment, which may extend to a period of 5 years plus fine. If amount is less than 5 crore, tax amount I'm referring to. If it is less than 5 crore, then this is called bailable offense. So for 2 to 5 crore, period of imprisonment is 3 years plus fine. If it is 1 to 2 crore, period of imprisonment is 1 year plus fine. For all subsequent offense, period of imprisonment would be 5 years. This is the provision for the arrest. But now I want to ask each one of you, and we have to discuss in today's webinar, learned speaker going to deliberate on the point, whether this arrest provision, it's constitutionally valid, first of all. If I go to apex court judgment, the settled judgment in the case of D.K. Basu, the settled legal jurisprudence is before arresting a person, there has to be arrest memo. An arrest memo must cite a region. For what region a person is getting arrested? Am I right? And that region must be communicated to him. And then only he should be brought before the judicial magistrate for remand, for the judicial custody. But such regions should have solid background. That should not be on the basis of apprehension. But what is happening today? In case of fake invoice, let's take an example. And I'm giving you the example. Let's say there are three parties, A, B, and C, in a supply chain. And let's say it is C who got the invoice from B. Now, on verification, it has come out that the B had purchased from A. A was only raising invoice, filing GSTR1, but not paying the taxes. B was availing credit because coming in is GSTR2A, and then filing GSTR1 and 3B using the same credit. Now, the problem is, how C would be knowing that whatever credit used by the B is a purchase from A and A has not paid the taxes? How C will come to know? And there are a lot of issues, circular trading. And we got a lot many things when we talk about fake invoices. So my only submission, we are arresting C when C does not know that B has purchased from A and A has mislead the transaction. to what extent C is responsible. Yes, B is responsible, no denial. Because B could have seen hit GSTR 2A, but that GSTR 2A came only in some early month of 2019. Prior to that, it was not there. So how B is expected to know that A is not paying the taxes, only cutting the invoices? I'm just giving food for thought, and these are very, very important and can be arrested just on the basis of reason to believe, in the tagline reason to believe that C is a culprit. To my mind, we have lot of things to deliberate and substantiate. Nevertheless, move next. Parallel proceedings in GST. I know GST is a dual levy, center and state. And we are being assigned to a particular department, either central or state. But only humble submission, and which I'm asking all of you, whether for any inspection, search and seizure, both the department can initiate under Section 6, Subsection 2, Clause B of CGST Act. There is specific provision. If any proceedings initiated by center, then state should not go, or vice versa. Same proceeding, the word used, same proceedings. So they should not go and overlap each other. I'm giving you two examples of my own client, where we have come across this parallel proceedings is going like anything. In one of my client case, first state visited, they checked out, they did inspection, search and seizure, they checked everything, and they have said, yes, there is no tax evasion and you are complying with the law. Then DGGI from central came and started search and seizure for the same subject matter, which was already done by the state officer, already done by the state officer. And then issued the so-called notice. Is it possible? That is the point which I'm making to all of you. Second case of one of my client, first state started the inspection, then anti-evasion authority came in, and thereafter DGGI came in. And anti-evasion has looked at, let's say, 3 transactions, and DGGI coming, looking at the balance 7 transactions, and still there are some transactions left out. I never know. Then a state may once again come back. If this kind of proceedings goes on, then I'm not finding that this is going to help us. This is going to help all of us together. And these parallel proceedings will create unease of business and should be stopped somewhere. It cannot be kept open. Recently, Calcutta High Court, in the case of Raj Metal Industries, has categorically said, when center is already doing the investigation, state should not issue the summon and they should not initiate any search seizure proceedings. But we are finding divergent judgment also. What is the meaning of same proceedings? It is on transaction. I may have 100 transactions. Can it be categorized and bucket that for 5 transactions, center will do, and for 5 transactions, state will do, and we never know 90 transactions again and again, they will come back. And this is not the case. If someone who has initiated, let him check everything, whatever he want to do, but should not create unease of business. So parallel proceedings, another subject matter, to what extent it is constitutionally valid. I've given you divergent judgment existing today, but still under Section 6, Subsection 2, Clause B, I've given my submission to you that for same proceedings, both cannot start, center and state cannot start parallel proceedings. If parallel proceedings exist, then that is going to be contrary with the provision of the Act and will create unease of business. Having said that, the important aspect, fifth item, recently I have seen one Supreme Court judgment, and which you would be knowing, in the case of Parambir Singh Saini versus Baljeet Singh and others, and very important judgment. And what is that judgment, you know? It is being stated there would be installation of CCTV camera at offices of all investigation agencies like DRI, police station. An honorable apex court has demanded a report from principal secretary of all state whether they have installed the CCTV camera where interrogation is being done, arrests are being made. In my humble submission, it must be done for all investigation authority under GST as well, be it for center like NTA evasion, DGGI, or maybe state. Why can't they put up the CCTV camera? Recently, yesterday night, I got a call from a client, and what is the call? Listen very carefully. A person who is a chartered accountant, and he's being summoned, and after getting summoned, he has gone and appeared before the authority. What authority is doing for last 2 days, he's being detained in the office of DGGI. He's not officially arrested. Now, my humble submission, I do not know what kind of proceedings are going on. He's being detained for last 2 days. In what context he's being detained? Either he should be arrested. In case you feel like he's the person, he's in connivance with the taxable person, taxpayer, you arrest him. But you can't detain for 2 continuous days in your office. Is it possible that the investigation officer goes for search and seizure, stay back at the residence for 2 nights, where all the family members, including wife and mothers, are there in the home, and they are staying back two nights? Gujarat High Court has come heavily on them and said, how come it is possible? And even I'm asking so. But since I'm saying chartered accountant, I want to alarm here. Section 132, subsection 1 is now putting rider. And you have seen a lot of, you know, cases wherein professionals are being captured, arrested. And it is coming out from provision of section 132. Whoever has committed, that may be a taxpayer. But who causes to commit and retaining benefit? So be all professional need to be little alert enough now. We should create a basic protection for ourselves, firewall for ourselves, so that we should not get into a trap of causes to commit and retaining benefit. Otherwise, you have seen a lot of, you know, cases where we are hearing that professionals are being arrested. We have to be careful. And similar provision for arrest and fine, even for the person who causes to commit and retaining the benefit. Last of my today's theme presentation, and just to ignite your mind. Search and seizure, I do know that this is happening so widely. These provisions are being made to check tax evasion. It was never meant to harass the honest taxpayer. I do agree search and seizure provision must be initiated against the person who are evading the taxes. And this reason to believe must be used in proper sense, in realistic sense, in right and spirit. But things are going little contrary. I'm sorry to say that. And in this process, lot of honest taxpayers are being harassed. There may be a dispute that an honest taxpayer is having his own interpretation of law. Maybe he's having own interpretation and classification, hence applying the corresponding rate. He's claiming ITC because he's bona fide, claiming after satisfying 4 conditions of section 16, subsection 2. Can you penalize him in the name of that 2A or 2B? I'm only giving food for thought. And just one judgment of Madras High Court. What happened during the search and seizure? One person had accepted the liability. Whereas he was not agreeing, but you know, during search and seizure under stress and duress, sometime you accept the liability. And it is always demanded that you must pay some component of tax liability there and there itself. He deposited 1 crore rupees. There was 2 crore rupees liability was finalized. And later on, this taxpayer coming out and saying, no, there's no liability exists. Whatever 1 crore rupees I have paid under stress and duress. It is nowhere my liability. So what to be done? There are 2-3 questions coming out to my mind. Whether statement can be retracted, which he has given, but for sure he is saying under stress and duress. Coercion. He has deposited 1 crore. Whether department can collect any tax at the time of search and seizure. Under which provision of the Act? Which provision of the Act is supporting to collect the tax amount? And it is not a tax amount as per the taxpayer. And third, what is the way forward? How we can resolve such issues? One Madras High Court judgment, Sri Nandi Dhal Meals Company Limited, and very good judgment. The 1 crore rupees which is deposited during search and statement was stated to be, yes, my liability, but as you know, under stress and coercion, later on this taxable person has retracted his own statement and wrote to the department, this liability does not exist. And whatever you have collected, you must refund back the money. And case has gone to Madras High Court. And what Honorable Madras High Court has held in this case, that whatever money collected during search and seizure is not authorized by the law. If at all we assume it's a fraud case under Section 74 of CGST Act. So under Section 74, subsection 5, there's a provision either on own ascertainment by the taxable person or ascertained by the proper officer. This tax may be demanded along with interest and 15% penalty, but that has to be accepted by the taxable person. He's not agreeing to. And what Honorable Madras High Court further said, when this taxable person was giving all information to the department, supporting, providing all information, then department could have issued the so-called notice. But they could not have collected this amount in the name of advance tax, which taxable person is not agreeing to. And this 74 subsection 5 is not the provision. Own ascertainment, either taxable person should ascertain his liability or ascertain by the proper officers. This is not the case. And section 73 subsection 7, if proper officer saying liability exists and it is not accepted by the taxable person, then they are supposed to issue a so-called notice. And that should have been done. But without doing so-called notice, collecting the tax amount, which is not the tax amount, this should be stopped somewhere. But nevertheless, it was theme presentation. We got all learned speakers to deliberate their topic at length. So I was thinking to just ignite your mind, get you prepared for today's webinar so that you can apply your mind and enjoy today's session. So with this, let me sum up my theme presentation, thanking each one of you. I got 558 participants as of now for this webinar. And we are going to discuss all these important components, inspection, search, seizure, arrest, recovery, provisional assessment. We are going to discuss at length. So with this, let me say thanks to each one of you for your patient listening. Thank you very much.